wish I could take it off and pin it on here, but the red areas are areas where we would fill on wetlands. This is the line for the sewer pipe that goes from the house in Lot 2 to the septic disposal system in Lot 2, and this is the wetland impact. We've spoken to two contractors who say the width of that ditch, which is temporary, needs to be 2 feet. We've allowed 6 feet in our calculations. This is the portion of the driveway in the Lot 2, which crosses wetland, and this is the driveway in Lot 1, which crosses wetland. The total of those three impacts is 2,860 square feet. This doesn't show on the plan I gave you because, again, this is revised information. In summary, we feel that the information that we've presented you both meets the letter and the intent of the wetland ordinance, that being to preserve significant wetlands. We feel that the conservation easement that we propose to grant to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, the pedestrian easement into the pond wetland behind the property, all speak for our interest in protecting the wetlands, and we think that our development has been presented in a manner that's both responsible and up to date. And unless there's any further questions, we'd certainly seek your approval of our subdivision.
Are there any questions of board members or comments? Mrs. Scottsboro.
Yes, I'd like to make reference to the letter from Mr. Hardcastle concerning the disposal system. Now, one of the soil scientists in the overlay has just shown some little yellow blobs, which are the only suitable places for the septic systems on these three lots. And my question would be, in a sensitive area like this, what is the lifetime expectancy of those septic systems? And should they fail, where would you go next since you have so few areas?
Can you refer that question to Rich?
Sure.
There has only been one study in the state of Maine with regard to failure rates of subsurface wastewater disposal systems, and that's based on the new system that was adopted in 1974. So we've got about 14 years experience. And that was done through computer work with 10 years of research. And it shows that 1 out of 1,000 systems statewide fails within the first year due to all kinds of reasons, either improper installation, poor design, abuse, or what have you. There's about 1% of the systems were failing within 5-year period, and there was a range of between 3% and 5% of the systems had failed within a 10-year life period. So as far as the life expectancy of the system, it's a little bit young to project how long these systems should last, but we're finding that 3% to 5% have gone bad within the first 10 years. The only relevant research comes out of Connecticut, where they project the life of a disposal system to be about 20 years. These areas, these yellow areas, are areas that were found by me and confirmed by the State of Maine Department of Human Services site evaluator to be acceptable. So they meet the subsurface wastewater disposal rules. So it would probably correlate that this soil would behave similar to what they have studied in the last 10 years.
But at the end of the 25 years,
yes,
the life expectancy, where does a person go from there?
What normally happens there is when a site is developed, a lot of the land use trends on the parcel have already been committed. In other words, the well, the driveways, the house site, the area where the effluent line exits the building, they've all been selected. So in a lot of cases, the system is rebuilt essentially in the same area. These would be chamber systems. Those are, you're probably aware of them, concrete.
Yeah, I've seen them.
And they can be brought up, reused in the same place with the soil regenerated. right there. So the likelihood that is that the same areas would be reused if and when it was necessary.
Mm-hmm. And one more question, Madam Chairman, about the drainage. I'd like to make reference to a letter from Mr. Maxwell concerning his strawberry fields, et cetera. And when I looked at this site last Sunday, I spent quite a bit of time in there and actually got lost, but found my way out. The only drainage I saw in the front of the property, adjacent to the road, which incidentally has extremely soft shoulders, the Two Lights Road shoulders I'm talking about. The only drainage I saw was a somewhat primitive and barbaric trench that was overgrown. Is that the drainage which is going to be used?
Actually, there's three culverts that exist under Two Lights Road for drainage, and the drainage is in this direction. There's a 14-inch culvert that the water drains through for the major stream that exists right here.
Mm-hmm.
There's an 18-inch culvert that the water drains through that and meanders somewhat in this direction and heads back towards the rear of the property, eventually towards the pond. And then there's a 12-inch culvert in this area, which takes the surface runoff from a swale over in the strawberry fields, and after a heavy precipitation will run through that, and then there's a swale right in this direction that also directs the surface water runoff towards the rear of the parcel and towards the pond. So there's three culverts across the road.
And what about the drainage? It seems to be just a primitive pit alongside the road there, which seems to have been designed for the runoff from the road.
That you may have to speak to that, John, but if I may, Mrs. Guthrie, that the ditch that you're referring to is the uppermost on the land, and it comes parallel to the road for a while,
yes,
where it's obvious,
does.
And then it goes back across through the area that we have proposed to the conservation easement along to the land trust. It basically follows along through this red area, making it the most critical of the wetlands. But there's nothing, there's no proposed development in or near that stream bed or ditch, if you will, anywhere.
Thank you.
The only thing that I would add is you're right that it is fairly overgrown, the ditch along the Two Lights. However, there are two or three outlets to that ditch, as Tony just explained. So they get those outlets and then run to the rear of the site.
Yes, it's so hidden it's almost dangerous for pedestrians or cars thinking that they can pull over. My God. They'd fall into this huge ditch, and there are no warnings, and it all appears very primitive and barbaric. And
as part of our subdivision, we'd be happy to put up a sign, do not back up here. But other than that, we have no proposed intervention on that ditch or the stream bed, because most of it is going to be in the conservation easement area.
Madam
Chair? Yes, Mr. Tennyson.
If we could refer to ditches and give them kind of barbaric. Nice to see we have some character left.
You're going to put the ditches in to keep the barbarians out.
Madam Chairman, just as a comment, I'm really impressed with the presentation that's been made and the detailed analysis of where the wetlands are and how we should be looking at wetlands. And it's always a question the planning board has, and I think even more so in the future. So I think that, from my perspective, there's been a lot of answers here tonight about where wetland flows are and the materials presented, how drainage is flowing, and that sort of thing. Before I move to the question or make the motion, if somebody else wants to make it, I did have some other questions that aren't wetland, necessarily wetland related, although one is a wetland related issue. When you're drawing, which is presented to the planning board, you indicated different fill amounts than we've indicated tonight. And I would presume that, I don't know how those differences are, but there may be a couple thousand square feet of difference.
Do you want to respond to this?
I'll take your first question first, Mr. Tinson. The discrepancy in these filled lands, plan that you're in possession of basically utilizes a 15-foot wide strip of land along that the sewer drainage on Lot 2. The driveway of 1,200 square feet in Lot 1 was unchanged. The driveway in Lot 2 is unchanged, and the reason that we presented different data with the chart with the red lines on it was basically that we were trying to show that we could reduce the amount of square footage filled to less than what the proposed new ordinance would call for, of basically 1,000 square feet per lot or 3,000 square feet for the three lots. Again, our contractors that we've asked said they'll dig a 2-foot ditch and they'll fill it back in. Obviously, the tractor's going to impact in some land. We used 6 feet in the numbers I gave you tonight, 15 feet before, and there's what the stretches.
John, you're more versed with the site distance issue. That has been brought up, and the police have been involved, but John might allow it.
We did look at the, I guess the most critical lot for site distance is Lot 1, and we've located the driveway in this location here with respect to complying with the ordinance for site distance. It's not clearly shown on this plan, but there's a note on the site plan deck that says northerly site distance for lot number 1 equals 350 feet. That was field measured.
Any other comments or questions before we...
Madam Chairman, I would like to hear if Dr. Rand has any comments that he would like to make on the wetlands issue.
We were essentially in complete agreement with everything that Al Frick said and John Lardy and Tony about this property. The first thing that Al said was that using this base map, and all of the colored areas in there represent wetlands as they are now described and defined in the Cape Elizabeth Wetlands Ordinance. In fact, they all are, except for some Lyman soils and one area of fill down here, and I don't believe the DEP will say that fill land that's filled on wetlands are not still wetlands. Nevertheless, it was the Conservation Commission's impression that essentially all of this land was in fact wetlands under the definition of our present ordinance. As we discussed this further, we came to as John went on and discussed and described his vegetative perimeters of the wetlands here, we found that we had a misunderstanding of our ordinance. That misunderstanding was that we, the Conservation Commission, felt that either criteria, either the vegetative criteria or the wetland criteria, would make a land soil Cape Elizabeth a wetland. If an area had soil characteristics of a wetland, regardless of whether it had vegetative characteristics or not, it was a wetland. And I do believe there's quite a bit of precedence in the action of the planning board in making decisions similar to that in previous developments in town, one of which might have been Stonegate, for example. And so we discussed this, and came to the conclusion that this was our we had one idea, they had the other idea, and it would be up to the planning board or the town councilor to make that decision.
And I, if I can just interrupt, I think that our town council has commented on that point, has advised the board on that point.
Okay. The second thing that we discussed, we had in front of us a plan that showed three house lots and had footprints of those houses, had driveways to those houses, water mains, sewer lines, and so forth. And we calculated the area that would have been disturbed in lots 1, 2, and 3 in each to see whether or not the 5,000 foot exemption was met. And we found that, in fact, it was met in lot 1, where there was less than 5,000 square feet that would be disturbed, but that were the plans that were indicated on the map carried out, that it would exceed 5,000 square feet both in lots 2 and lots 3. Nonetheless, we then gave the developers our advice, which was, you have a wetland. If you need to, if you're going to do things on that wetland, any filling, draining, etc., you should go to the planning board and see whether or not you meet the standards of the wetlands ordinance. The other option they would have would be to not do that, but await the passage, and I'm not sure how long it's going to take, of the new wetlands ordinance, which is going to reduce some of the constraints, particularly where these ore-gray soils are, and there would be less wetland to be concerned with.
Madam Chairman, I have a question. With the new ordinance, what would the wetlands look like for the site?
The new ordinance has three characteristics. It has a severe wetlands and wetland soils, and poorly drained, help me out here, Al, or Steve, critical areas, where that might go, critical wetlands, and these would be areas in which there would be essentially very little development and no structures allowed. And the only one there is Sebago and West Chris and this one is Whately. Would Whately be such a soil?
No.
So that one would be one of which it would be extreme
critical.
However, all of the other ones, with the exception of Oil Gray, as I understand it, which is this orange one, would then be a wetland protection zone, and a special permit would have to be required to do that development on them. But they, rather than there being an absolute restriction, they still would have to come to the planning board for approval of any development on them.
So would the so if the new ordinance were in place, would it fairly closely resemble the cross-hatching of the federal?
The new ordinance contains both.
Do you think?
The new ordinance does have vegetative criteria in it, as have been described tonight. I didn't find them.
It appears where the wetlands are defined.
And it says here that, yes, are periodically, at least periodically, the land supports wetland plants listed as obligate. Two, the substrate consists predominantly of wetland soils characterized as very poorly drained organic and mineral soils. That the substrate consists predominantly of wetland soils characterized as poorly drained as opposed to very poorly drained. And the substrate is saturated with water to the surface or covered by shallow water for at least 20 consecutive days, that number is, we discussed, may be changing around during the growing season. So you have both vegetative characteristics and soil characteristics.
To the question that Mrs. Rand raised, would it look like the crosshatched area on this map?
Just off the top of your head.
Yes. But I don't believe, as I read this, and we have to discuss this, this ordinance is in the process of being made. I still believe that both, either criteria would call it a wetland, whether it had a vegetative or if it had soils characteristics.
And then basically, isn't that what our attorney is telling us we should be guided by?
Yes, we have a letter, and I think, Tom, maybe you want to address that now, since we're discussing it, but we do have a letter which interprets that.
That's not in our package, or
is it? Is it not?
I have a problem with
it. I haven't seen it. We have one, but it doesn't relate to that issue.
The letter that Alice was referring to is actually a memo from me to the board, which was based on a conversation Tom and I had about the narrow question regarding whether or not it was an and or a combined.
We don't have a letter from Tom.
No.
No, I'm sorry.
I don't remember it.
No.
Maybe that makes my answer shorter, but I do agree with that interpretation that under the existing wetlands definition, I read it as it can be a wetland under the first part or the second part. It's separated by a semicolon. It seems like two distinct ways of defining it, and you don't have to qualify into both. Either one would define it as wetland today. I don't know how that relates to the new proposed ordinance, and we have to make clear that's a proposed one, and whether that has both ways of defining it as well, I'm not sure.
While we have you right there, I think it might be helpful to the board. I think there is some confusion as to whether the planning board even has jurisdiction to let the applicant go through a wetlands alteration permit with us, since they are not doing the road development. They are merely doing the subdivision.
Well, the question is whether under your criteria for subdivision review, you even get to wetlands directly. And basically, it's only when you have an applicant who applies for wetland alteration permit do you review wetlands. And the question to me was whether a subdivider, someone who is simply dividing the land but not doing any improvements upon the land, whether he needs to come before you for a wetlands alteration permit. That permit, as I see it, requires an application to say, this is what we're going to do, this is what's going to be altered, and when he leaves here, if he gets the permit, must secure to the town his development or his alteration to be in conformance with that permit. I read that to require the person who's actually doing the work to come before you, and in many instances, like a single family house subdivision, would not be the applicant. It would be if he was doing roads. It would be if it was perhaps a condo project where he would have to be doing the infrastructure. But this subdivider is simply asking you to put lines or approve of the division of land by the insertion of lines to make three lots. He is not proposing all the wetlands. He may sell the whole package as one lot. He may sell it as three. They may be developed in the way he's proposed. I think you can restrict where, I've seen in the past where you have restricted where houses may be presented in accordance with their plans, or replaced in accordance with where they are presented. I'm not sure exactly how that jives, but I think the first question is, do you have jurisdiction, does he need to apply for wetlands alteration permit? And I'm not sure that he's doing anything. He's not proposing to alter, he's just asking for subdivision approval. What I've recommended is to make clear that you have not reached a final decision on wetlands is to, if you do approve it, that you do it with a condition on the plan that expressly states that you have not reviewed nor approved a wetland alteration permit for the development upon any of the lots, and that that should be borne on the plan as well as in a deed, so that any buyer doesn't see that by subdivision approval that you have actually approved wetland alteration.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Tom, let's take a hypothetical situation here, that the subdivision of the land as you describe it goes ahead, there are three lots,
right,
and these lots are sold, and a homeowner comes into our code enforcement office and wants to put a 50-foot wide driveway through to his house and disturbs in excess of 5,000 square feet. Single homeowner, would that be allowed?
No. He'd have to get
a
wetlands alteration permit.
So I don't see how we can avoid the issue. I think the issue is before us, either now or later. It's going to be before us on the sale of this property. There's a wetlands issue.
Well, I don't know that he's going to... What if he doesn't want to do that with the property? What if he wants to add it to his adjoining lot? What if he doesn't meet the 5,000? He looks at it and says, I can place my house and driveway on there in a manner that does not require me to get a wetlands alteration permit. I guess that's what I'm saying is we don't know. The subdivider isn't locating the houses, nor is he proposing to alter the wetlands. He's saying how it can be done. I'm not sure what your past experience has been on wetlands alterations, how often it's combined with subdivision approval when the applicant is not doing those improvements. If he's putting in the road and he has to alter wetlands to put in the road, I see that as clearly within your initial jurisdiction. I agree with you. If he gets to the point where an individual homeowner who presumably has read it on a plan, has a deed that says that, he can be protected by conditioning his sale and saying, gee, my attorney in the bank before I close said I can't close unless I get a wetlands alteration permit. I want to condition my contract to buy on my getting that permit from the planning board. So we'll close when I get back from the planning board.
So we potentially face three wetlands alteration situations.
Yeah. Depending on each lot, you take each lot as it comes, as to what the characteristics are, what he proposed to do for an alteration.
Mr. Gross.
Mr. Leahy, so if we were to pass this as a subdivision, the building footprints that it shows, the driveways that it shows, where the subjects would be located, we are not passing that as a fact on the subdivision. The footprint can be moved anywhere, and the person that buys the lot or the piece of property can actually come in and do whatever they want, and we are not passing that as stipulated.
I think what's happening is that what I'm trying to make clear is simply who should apply for the wetlands alteration permit. I think that within the subdivision criteria, you have to know that there's adequate ability for private septic systems. So it already comes to you that he must locate a septic system somewhere. And if you have a lot of wetlands, that comes up. So it may be that he has to come before you to say, look, this is where we can locate houses and septic systems. You know, I guess I'm not sure historically what you've done on these, but I think what he is trying to show you, at least at a minimum, that he can place three septic systems, and I think the issue has come up and they've tried to address it. There may be another interpretation, but that's the one I've read, is that the applicant, if you read just wetlands alteration permit, the applicant for that is the person who proposes to alter.
I think perhaps the planning board has been frustrated on this point and frustrated on the interpretation of it, and so this is why we're pressing a little hard tonight.
All right.
One of
the things we have done, though, just for Greg's knowledge, is on the final plan that is approved or signed, we have, in my memory, conditioned those final plans on location of structures as shown on those. Typically, that isn't done. In fact, usually we don't get shown any structures at all, unless it's a condominium project or unless the developer is putting in the houses. But if somebody is concerned, it seems to me there's a way to condition that approval on structures, roads, and other things being located where the planning board wants them to be.
Yes, Mr. Butler.
To follow up on what Mr. Bodger just said, right now the plan indicates a building zone, which isn't as specific and narrowly defined as what Mr. Bosch was saying in terms of that specific building location, but the building zone does identify the area within which all structures could be constructed. Again, that could be under or over 5,000 square feet.
I thank you, Mr. Leahy, unless there's some more questions. I think we have perhaps a couple of options here to move forward. I think perhaps the planning board, the developer, and the conservation commission agrees that that this is a large parcel of wetlands. It has been suggested that perhaps the planning board cannot really accept a wetlands alteration permit from this present developer. However, it might anticipate accepting wetlands alteration permits from the builders down the road. And I think the Conservation Commission, as well as Mr. Leahy, has delineated a way to carry out the intent of our wetlands ordinance, which is to qualify this in a deed and in the plans itself to alert the potential buyer that that this has not yet gone through a wetlands alteration permit and that it may have to. And so I think that's one option. Another option, I believe, would be to wait until our new, I think we do have to deal with our present ordinance. I think that's the current one that we're dealing with, and we aspire to this, and I think this is a beautiful job. So that is another option. But that may run into some lengthy time. We're not uncertain about that. And any questions?
Madam Chairman, I will not be voting on this issue, but I have a quick question regarding the applicability of the new ordinance, assuming that it is approved by the council. And that has to do with its effect on approval of a minor subdivision at this point. Would the new ordinance apply to any future wetlands alteration on a subdivision that was approved tonight, if we were to approve it tonight?
Madam Chairman, I don't believe that there's a retroactivity clause in the draft wetlands ordinance, which is what I think you're getting at this point in time. There may be one suggested to be added later on.
I also had a question for the applicant, and he may or may not be prepared to answer it, but Dr. Owen, what was your expectation tonight regarding our actions regarding wetlands alteration?
I'm not sure I am prepared to answer that, Joel. I feel that we've presented all the information that we have to present, and I think the ball is basically in your court to make a decision with the information we're giving you. I think that the conditions that Alice presented would be acceptable to Gary and myself, that being that the subdivision is approved and the sale of the lots contain a clause that would alert the buyer that the wetland alteration permit may, as Mr. Leahy pointed out, may be necessary. In fact, Mr. Malley made that one of the alternatives in the Conservation Commission. I mean, offered that as a suggestion. Obviously, we're not applying for a wetlands alteration permit. I guess the tenet behind my presentation is that we felt that what we've shown is that we're not altering wetlands because I've already gone through that. I can understand the position the board's taken with the current ordinance. So. I guess that's the best answer I can give you.
Yes, Mr. Ross. Yes, please do.
Dr. Owen, on your map when you showed the red areas where you're going to alter the wetlands, you didn't show any water. Where is the water going to be coming in? The water means from two lights. Underneath the driveway?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Lindsay, do you agree with Mr. Butler that if we pass this as a subdivision tonight, that it will fall under the new wetlands ordinance whenever that comes online?
Well, it depends when you are requested to approve
wetlands. No, but if everything falls in place and we get that in line and after it's been passed and approved and everything, then an applicant comes in, then they fall under the new category.
As I understand it, there's no retroactivity date, so that's correct. That's what I would say. It would not be under the old, it'd been a new, because that's when you're applying. The retroactivity date in it, if
so
they say...
The argument couldn't be made that they got the subdivision approved at this point in time under a different set of rules, and now, and me being the applicant that wants to come in and build, I want those same rules applied to me that they got the subdivision under?
I would think on this sort of an ordinance would be they would not be grandfathered for that sort of an ordinance, a use ordinance. They may be grandfathered in some respects, but I think the subdivision then is a grandfathered subdivision. What they can do with the property is subject to reasonable regulations. If you change, you know, as I think our argument has been in some other cases that you've heard as recently as this evening, I mean, I think you can further regulate land, whether it's lots, you know, in some cases, whether it's setbacks or other things, you can have reasonable regulation of land thereafter. So if you have a wetlands and you change the wetlands ordinance to a new one with some different definitions, I think you're pretty safe in it, because that's when the permit is applied for. And I also think that if they want to apply for it, if they say, we are the applicant, we do want to apply for it, I got to make clear that I think my opinion was given on the basis that if an applicant for subdivision review either has not or does not want to apply for a wetlands alteration permit, can the planning board require him to do so or withhold approval until he does so? And I said, well, in my opinion, no. You cannot hold that up. If he says, we are the ones, we intend to alter the wetlands, we want a permit in order to alter the wetlands for each of these lots, I think that's a different question. I think it's a difference with meaning. In other words, I think an applicant could voluntarily come under that and say, we're applying. Here's a permit. We're applying. Please approve it. We'll secure our performance.
And that would make it easier for the buyer when he comes in.
That's right. I mean, I'm not sure that's not such a crazy idea, mm-hmm. but it's up. My opinion is that if he doesn't want to, then you can't force him to. If he says, I'm not applying. I might sit on this for 5 years. I might never sell these. I'm not going to alter a thing. I'm selling these lots, and then the buyer is going to have to beware and do his own investigation and applying to your board. I just want to throw that out, because it sounded like it was a question of which would apply and whether he thought he was going to have it tonight. I want to make clear if he wants to. I don't see anything wrong with an applicant going through that if he wishes.
Thank you, Tom.
Yes,
Mr. Tinsman.
We have been talking about wetlands for years in this town, and we're all non-technical people, and unlike an application earlier tonight that wanted to change Resource Protection District to RA, when you walk on the side and your feet get wet, you know that you're in a wetland. If you go up out of that water and your feet are dry, you know that you're in an upland, and somewhere between you're transiting between a wetland and an upland. I don't know where that is, but I see a lot of lines drawn on maps that indicate where our criteria should be. I've walked the site. It appears as though the structures, the buildable areas, are located in areas that do not appear to be wet. But common sense tells me that if there's any technical basis for saying that that's not a wetland, then that appears to be a reasonable criteria. I think the motion is drafted very well. I will make the motion, but I'll make it on the basis that when an application comes in for a building permit, the intent of making this motion is that it will then turn to ordinance. And I say that specifically for the 5,000 and the 1,000 square foot criteria, that I would hate to see an applicant come in 5 years and use the 5,000 square feet when we've been maybe using 1,000 square feet in the previous 4 years. So if we have to review tapes in 4 years, either audio or visual, that the intent be clear that it's at the time of the building permit application, and if it's 1,000 square feet, then that's what the...
I think that's a good amendment to suggest to this motion that we have.
Oh, I could have suggested an amendment.
A pardon? No. I think just go ahead and state it. But I think that's a good.
Excuse me,
just a minute. Did you have a question? Tape changing?
No. I had a comment. I'll wait to see what Mr. Kinkin's going to do.
Go ahead and make the comment.
Okay. The comment is that the applicants have indicated that there's been at least one change to the final plan, which the planning board hasn't seen. I think that was dealing with the amount of wetlands to be altered. I just wanted to ask the applicant if there are any other changes on the final plan that would make the plan that might be approved tonight substantially different than what you, than the version of the plan that you have in your hands.
No, Steve, there aren't any other changes. That was really for a point of illustration, I think is moot given the board's decision about what's wetland and what isn't, and especially since we're not applying for wetland permit, that there are no other changes.
Just as a follow-up, I might suggest, just to ensure that's the case, that another condition might be that staff review the plan to get signed, if it does get signed tonight, to make sure it's compatible with what's been submitted before. This is a kind of an extra precaution. Not sure it's necessary.
Madam Chairman, I would like to make the motion. Be it ordered that the Planning Board finds that the proposed Spinnaker Heights subdivision at the three-lot minor subdivision located off Two Lights Road and proposed by Tony Owens and Gary Cummings meets the requirements of Section 1611A through N, 1631 and 1633 of the subdivision ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of Tony Owens and Gary Cummings for final plan approval of Spinnaker Heights be granted according to Section 1623 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. A, that the proposed statement shall be placed on the final subdivision plan and inserted into the individual lots deeds to quote the three individual lots that make up the Spinnaker Heights subdivision have not received a planning board permit for wetlands alteration, which may be required prior to the issuance of a building permit per section 1939 of the zoning ordinance, and that any application for a building permit comply with the then current town wetland regulations, if that does that issue. And B, that the tree plantings indicated on the final plan shall be accomplished prior to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy.
You heard the motion. Is there a second? It has been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Madam Chairman, I'll be very brief. And again, I'm not voting, but I want to make this observation. This is a minor subdivision. There are only three lots. But the amount of time and the thoughtfulness that went into the preparation of it, I think, should not be wasted on this board. There is a significant conservation area that is being suggested by the applicant, which is of tremendous benefit to the town. There is also a pedestrian easement of 15 feet that is a small portion of our larger greenbelt plan that we're all interested in seeing come to some completion. And I think there has been also, assuming that this subdivision goes forward sometime in the future and meets the wetland standards and so forth, the siting of the buildings was done, and I think, in a very good manner. So I don't want some of the benefits of what is being proposed to be lost in our brief discussion of non-wetland issues.
Thank you, Mr. Russ. That was a good comment. Any further discussion or comments? If not, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. And opposed? It is unanimous. And you have your, you've been granted your approval. Do you have a pen to modify
the...
to be put in onto the plan?
Would you like us to submit a new plan? Do you need
a Right. We need a Mylar with these additions added to the plan. Do you have a Mylar?
I don't.
No, we don't. But you will need to get that before we... Right.
I'd assume at some point you want the board to sign the Mylar. Yeah, we can get those too. I guess a technical issue would be, would you be looking to coming back to the planning board for signing at the next meeting, or... Once notes are done, I mean, you have your approval with conditions.
I just assume not come back, actually. Right. Not that I haven't enjoyed the meeting.
We'd love to have you. it's possible that you can either have it signed, perhaps at a workshop meeting, which is...
Whatever is easiest. I didn't mean that facetiously. I'd be happy to bring it, come back in October, and present it or receive it.
It's probably better to do it in October. It's more official that way.
There are 90 days to register the subdivision. Will that begin after that signing in October, or is it commenced tonight?
Where's our legal counsel? Has he found?
Okay, recording that. Okay, it's going to be the day. I have a total approval.
If it's from approval, then that would be in the motion tonight, would it?
I guess conservatively, I'd say tonight. I mean, whether it might be signed tomorrow, might be signed at the workshop tonight. Generally, people don't wait around. Chairman, that's a matter of concern, probably. If they have it here tonight, and all the notes are on the plan, if they want to come back in 89 days, register the next day.
It's really not our concern.
Well, thank you for your presentation, and I assume we'll see you again. Say which lot that these pictures were put to. I'd like to do.
Okay. Okay. They don't vote.
Oh, that's this kind of business. Our next item of business before the 10 o'clock death knell here is Ibis Corporation coming in with a final plan review for Dyer Pond, and we are glad to see you back, Mr. Taylor. I'm glad you haven't forgotten us and realize there's been a little hiatus since the last time you were here, and we have adopted some new rules, one of which is that we hope that presentations would not exceed 15 minutes, so if we can go by that, that would be helpful, so we
Very
won't
good.
Go past the midnight hour.
Okay. We prepared and submitted an application for final plan approval, and we noted in that application that some of the detailed requirements for final plan approval had not yet been met. Amongst those are the DEP permits required are available at this time only in draft form. The final permit has not yet been signed by the commissioner.
Excuse me, when would you anticipate that occurring?
At the first week in October.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, there were many issues, or not many issues, but several issues left open in the preliminary plan approval that was conditioned, and we wanted to start the process of addressing those open issues, and they dealt primarily with the location of pedestrian easements as they crossed the site, and reservations made by the board in the granting of the wetlands alteration permit, so that they might review permits by others and impose conditions at this stage. We have submitted road and utility construction plans, specifications, and cost estimates. I do not believe that Mr. Hunter at T.Y. Lynn International has had a chance to review those yet, so we will be unable to respond to any comments, or don't expect this evening to respond to any comments in that area. I think that the first issue that we'd like to address is the question of pedestrian access provided by the proposed subdivision. The board may recall this plan, which was developed as a part of the preliminary subdivision application, where we noted that the brown lines shown here have been provided as part of pedestrian circulation from the Stonegate project, that the purple line following here was a potential pedestrian access through the adjacent land that we control but have not yet applied for any development permits on, and that the red lines were those proposed for this subdivision. At the time that we dealt with this issue, there was some concern, or there was a reservation or condition made in the final plan approval regarding pedestrian easements. We have shown the pedestrian easements in red that are shown on there in red that apply to the subdivision area on the plan. We have not inked them in yet because we felt they were subject to discussion. The pedestrian easements that would not appear on this plan, but would be granted, and those are these in this area, which falls entirely off this plan, would be granted in a separate document.
But to accompany the final plan?
It would basically be a deed, mm-hmm, rather than a plan.
This is a little difficult to see, probably in the lighting, but the green are all the existing pedestrian pathways on the site. We have proposed to add the blue as a part of this proposal. The green in the top part of the plan that I just ran my hand, but it's encompassed by my hand, all fall within the Stonegate subdivision. This area over here, from this point to your left, falls within the area that is not currently proposed for development. So we are proposing, if you will, to provide the blue, and the areas of green that are shown here as existing pathways will no longer by right, which is the same thing. situation that exists today be available for use by the general public. The situation today is that only those pedestrian pathways in Stonegate are available for use by the general public. We have determined that it is not appropriate to provide this pedestrian link because it terminates in the backyard of the Connell resident on Shore Road, and we didn't think that they'd like us conducting traffic there. We feel it's inappropriate to provide a pedestrian easement along with the alignment that I just indicated, since the same purpose is provided for the same general circulation from the beginning point to the end point is provided by the path proposed here. And that would run generally through the center of our building lots number 1, 2, 3, and 4. And we felt that that was an unwanted intrusion on the future homeowners.
Could you just point out 1, 2, 3, and 4?
1, 2, 3, and 4. Which are the, and five actually, which are the building lots northerly of the proposed Dyer Pond Road. So I think what I've done here is attempted to describe to the board our thought process in reaching the proposed alignment of pedestrian accessways, and would like to take comments and questions at this point.
Mrs. Guthrie?
Mr. Taylor. Going back to Stonegate, there was a pedestrian easement planned from Mitchell Road to Shore Road with a stockade fence. Is that in the offing? When will we have that?
Well, there was, the easement has been provided.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it was a part of the subdivision approval that a fence, not necessarily a stockade fence, would be built on the boundary line between the Stonegate parcel and Mrs. Van Longhausen's parcel at Shore Road for the first 300 feet is what I recall. It's our intent to construct that in the spring of 1989. But we have not yet started that. There was also a sidewalk to be built on Shore Road. We have not yet started that either.
Let me just ascertain what you said, that you propose eliminating the northern pedestrian easement running through lots 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5?
We don't propose eliminating any pedestrian easements. We propose establishing additional pedestrian easements.
Okay.
There happens to exist a path there that has been used by our sufferance to date, but we are proposing to provide a deeded pedestrian easement for the benefit of the citizens of the town in the alignment that is shown on this plan and in light blue on that plan.
That essentially provides a west-south
corridor.
Corridor and the east-west corridor through
your... That's correct.
Which makes it a little more interesting for those of us who go cross-country on other people's property.
Consider a small cul-de-sac.
I think the cul-de-sacs aren't terribly effective to people on foot.
Have you run these recent additions through by the Conservation Commission?
This plan, the original plan, was run by the Conservation Commission, and at that time, that's all the proposal that we made, and that appeared to be satisfactory to the Conservation Commission at that time. I believe it was Mr. Russ that suggested that we qualify or condition the final, or the preliminary subdivision approval
so that another look might be taken at this issue at this time. And we have not made a separate presentation to the Conservation Commission.
I think that might be useful just as a part of the process to confirm that.
I'd be happy to do that.
Are there any other comments or questions about the, Mr. Butler?
Madam Chairman, just a quick one. On the final plan right now, you show the pedestrian easement going to the end of where approximately the paved roadway would end. On that plan, you showed it, I believe, going up to the very end of the phase one boundary. Which one would apply?
In fact, the pedestrian easement would continue along the alignment of the right-of-way, and we did not delineate it specifically. So it would go where we've only shown it where it would be separate from the roadway, the 50-foot wide future road easement. That if I can repeat that out loud for the benefit of the rest of the board, the pedestrian easement, if it were traced on this plan by the tip of my pencil, would start here and go to the point, this point of intersection, and also start down here and come to that same point of intersection, follow this curve to a point short of where the paving ends for Dyer Pond Road, and then follow the alignment indicated by the dashed line that I am following with my pencil. That being the alignment of the existing gravel road, or this. Existing trail.
Any other questions or comments?
Just on that.
Pardon?
On the pedestrian easements, or could we start with something else?
I think it's only perhaps fair to just remind the board at this point that we are acting under an ordinance under 16-2-5, which says application for final approval within 6 months following decision upon preliminary plans. The applicant shall file with the building inspector for planning board consideration application for final approval of the subdivision with material herein prescribed, and a fee is established by the town council, and the fee has been paid. If such application is not filed within such period, the planning board may refuse without prejudice to act and may require resubmission of preliminary plans. The building inspector shall review the application and accompanying material to ensure the conformity with the decision upon preliminary plans and their inclusion on the following materials. And I guess that perhaps the last time we did see you was, what, February?
Well, if you'll recall, the
I don't.
preliminary subdivision approval with conditions was granted on February 16, even though application had been made for wetland alteration and resource protection at the same time as preliminary subdivision application, those permits were not granted until March 15 and March 22, respectively. So the last time we saw each other was March 22, but the date of preliminary subdivision approval was February 16.
I just would like the board to be aware of that. I think maybe we ought to go on to other points of discussion.
The The other issue that we would like to address this evening that was a condition of preliminary plan approval was the question of alteration of construction of the roadway in the area where it crossed the Resource Protection District and wetlands. We have applied, as I said, for the appropriate permits from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and received those, and received a draft permit from the Maine Department of Environmental Protection. Those permits envision construction as the proposal was originally presented to the board. And I wanted to ask if the board had any issues at this time dealing with that condition in the preliminary plan approval.
There was a lot of discussion and debate about this whole issue and the length of the road. We exceeded our limit. We granted a waiver. And that's not something that we like to do. However, are there any comments or questions at this point on that matter, or any feelings about that? Any sense of direction that you...
Chairman, not specifically on that issue. And I wasn't here for the preliminary plan approval, but I'm not conversant with some of the things, although I've read the material that has happened since then. But I think it's important that if there's direction that we're supplying for final plan review, that we've got some technical input into it. I don't think we have that yet. I would request, and certainly we're not going to be approving a final plan this evening. But what we really need is for our staff to look at each of the conditions and then to comment on each of the conditions and how they solved or resolved by the applicant. To the extent that the applicant is asking for questions tonight about how to handle something, given either new data or current board thinking, you should put those questions hard. I think we're talking about some other issues other than what we think about something. And Mr. Taylor started off talking about the pedestrian ways, which I think is appropriate, and revised thinking, and where are we now, and lots that have been approved. So I guess from a generic sense, I'd like to staff review on how the application is proposing to resolve some things. There are other questions that we might have tonight that the applicant may want to answer, such as, and Steve may want some input into it, Dyer Pond Associates as opposed to the Ibis Corporation. What happens with a change in name, what happens in financial capacity, and issues like that, and why the change from Ibis to Dyer Pond?
You've raised a couple of questions. We might as well
tell us some answers on that. The preliminary application was made in the name of Robert H. Taylor, Jr. and M. Dana Goodwin.
Not Ibis Corporation.
That's correct. And while the board's motion stated Ibis Corporation, we didn't think it was a germane issue at the time because Ibis Corporation is the developer of record.
What is the difference between Dyer Pond Associates and Ibis Corporation?
Well, Bob Taylor and Dana Goodwin own the land. Bob Taylor and Dana Goodwin own Ibis Corporation, and in 50% each in each case. They're both creatures of ours. And the information that the board acted upon, including the financial responsibility letter, was addressed with regard to Taylor and Goodwin rather than Ibis Corporation.
Ibis Corporation is a corporation under Maine law?
Yes, it is.
And Dyer Pond Associates is a partnership?
Yes, it is.
I guess, Madam Chairman, I would only ask, and not raising the issue to throw a stumbling block, and I really don't want to do that, but I'm just curious why our motion to the Ibis Corporation and whether we did that in error for preliminary plan review and what the process is to make sure that it's secure, that when we vote, that we don't, that we address who owns the land and who the application is truly from, so that there are no questions about that. We don't get snarled up in our own footwork as we're approving preliminaries and final plans. I frankly don't know what the process is. I understand what Mr. Taylor is saying. I just don't want to cause problems here for
I think that's a point well taken, and in the future, we shall try to straighten out who the presenter is, the developer, and get that correctly. There are a lot of unresolved issues, and I think the weir is one, and its access to it, and that is the sort of thing that only Mr. Hunter would need to review before we can perhaps make further comment on that.
And Julie, yes, this is also the access, and who will be responsible to check that weir? I don't think weirs last forever. And since there isn't an association, someone should be responsible. These weirs, I think, would be, and dams and dikes, would be on private property. And can the town enter upon that private property to check these?
The answer is that we have proposed that the town accept all the improvements and that appropriate rights of way would be granted to the town so that they could perform whatever inspection or maintenance was necessary.
Mm-hmm. Madam Chairman,
yes.
You just said rights of way. I found a new right of way on this final plan that you submitted to us. Yeah, I guess I didn't know. It must be my sloppy mistake, but I didn't notice it the last time. And is this right of way, which is running south off of Dyer Pond Road, is that new? On the last plan, I thought it was a T turnaround.
That was a condition of approval that the board made, I believe.
Was that to get to the weir?
Are we talking down here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, that's to provide, I believe, and I, you know, this was done in response to a concern of the board rather than ours, but I believe that the intent there is if the adjacent land is ever developed, there could be a through connection to Dyer Pond Road if it was deemed desirable.
I don't see that as something, a condition of approval. Where was that?
It is noted on the preliminary subdivision plan that was approved, and I guess I was mistaken in saying it was a condition of final plan approval, but it was added at the request of the town.
Who requested it?
I can't recall. This is the plan that was in front of the board at that time.
Yeah.
There it is.
But I thought that was a key turnaround, and on this particular plan it says right of way, and I just wondered, is this the right of way to get to the weir?
It is not the right of way to get to the weir.
It's a new right of way to the Pine Tree Acres land, is it?
No, this right of way, this land, it belongs to the Robinson heirs.
Oh, I see.
And I think it was put there that in the event there was future development and it was deemed appropriate that there be a through connection to Dyer Pond Road for some reason, that the property rights would exist to allow that.
Sure.
Either it didn't come from us. Mr. Butler?
Madam Chairman, one issue that I guess I'd like to get some direction from deals with the access easement to the weir. and on the preliminary plan, it looked like it was going to go between lots 1 and 2, the property line, and now it appears as though, I didn't understand where the access easement was coming from. All I know is that Bob Taylor, the town engineer, had suggested that to be able to get any sort of equipment up through the preliminary plans, access where you'd be going up through the slopes in excess of 30%, and so he kind of suggested that the board might want to ask for another one. So I want to make sure that you want to follow through that recommendation and maybe ask Mr. Taylor what the current proposal is right now.
The current proposal is that access to the weir take place along the pedestrian easement, which is basically a road at this point in time, from Dyer Pond Road at this location along that alignment, and that we provide a 50-foot wide strip along the northern project boundary from that roadway, existing roadway, into the weir.
And that has no 30% slope.
Right, that's appropriate for
heavy equipment.
Yes. Yes. Initially, it was proposed to come directly from Dyer Pond Road along the boundary line between lot 1 and 2.
Madam Chairman, so that would show up in the 50-foot wide pedestrian easement?
Where it's an existing road, it can show up as a 20-foot wide easement. But we need the 50-foot wide easement up north here because we have to dodge around a few knobs of ledge to get through there with the construction equipment.
So you would be showing on the plan a 20-foot wide easement where the road is going.
That's correct. And the center line of that is the dashed line shown there.
Anything else? I think perhaps we can't make too much headway tonight, Mr. Taylor, because of our restrictions on having the staff be able to review, and we will try to achieve that by the next time, and
I would like
to have further.
My only request is that if the staff is going to conduct this review in the approximately 1 month before the next meeting, that we could be provided with a summary of this review so that prior to the meeting, so that we might respond appropriately as to either agreeing with, disagreeing with, or proposing alternative approaches so that we might move ahead expeditiously.
That's a reasonable request.
Madam Chairman, there is a time restriction in the ordinance, and I'm not. That really applies when someone, an applicant, is proceeding in good faith to complete a project with its preliminary approval. I certainly don't think that that's the case in this applicant's case, and I don't know if that applies for continuing good faith attempt to close out a project. Final plan review to me, and maybe not to other members of the board, is really almost a pro forma review and approval unless there are conditions that are left open by the preliminary plan review and approval process. We spend all of our time in the preliminary plan review looking at the technical issues of a proposed development and resolving them, and then conditioning that preliminary plan review. To me, the most important aspect of the final plan approval process is that, number one, the final plan is in conformance with the preliminary plan. Everything is the same. Issues like the road, was that the way it was when you came through? Yes, it was. The other issue is the resolution of any of the conditions that the planning board has imposed on that approval process. And I don't know that Steve has enough data, maybe he does, to go over and check off each one of those conditions that are on the preliminary plan approval in February for final plan approval tonight. I don't sense that there is, and I think it should maybe there is. We had sheets of plans for preliminary plan review. We have one sheet for final plan review. presumably Steve has got more than that to make sure he's set the performance bond, which we have a figure of $219,350, I presume, for this portion of the project. But once staff has reviewed it, once staff has said okay and all of the preliminary plan conditions that we've attached, I would think that we should include it very quickly after that.
I think you're right. We have to wait, and we have to make sure that we have other permits have actually been secured in addition to that, such as the DEP, and that would be important to make sure that that comes in.
I think, just to correct you, I don't think that $219,000 figure is for this development.
If I may respond, we recognize that we don't have final DEP plan approval. We recognize that we're beyond the 6 months from February 16th, but we felt that since the conditions were nonspecific with regard to construction in the wetlands and with regard to the alignment of pedestrian easements, it was appropriate to at least get some response from the board at this stage.
I hope that you have gotten enough to...
I think that with the detailed review of the submission by the staff, we can respond more fully.
Good. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Taylor. And we will see you in October. We have a few items left on our agenda. Mr. Most is making a push for the rear of the room. I think it's conceivable that we could delay on some of these, but some of them might not take very long. So perhaps the best thing to do is to skip the subdivision ordinance amendments, since those will be... Have you copied those?
I have a few copies.
Have you all received copies of the subdivision ordinance amendments?
No. Well, you did at the last Pine Board workshop.
You forgot to bring them with you tonight. So we will try to address that perhaps in a workshop. And the Planning Board rules and regulations, did you receive a copy of that? What?
I had a question as of tonight in terms of whether or not the comments from the Town Council were received.
You did not receive a copy? No.
I
don't
have it. I have an old one.
Let me just tell you what's happened then. The Town Council has made a few revisions, as is their right, under the Town Charter, to our rules and regulations.
Do you want to stay at a full question?
Fortunately, Marion Guthrie talked them out of that. But we will need to address those and recommend that, unless we have any disagreements about what they're asking for, that they return to the Town Council for final adoption.
If I can just follow up. You'll see copies of it. I apologize for those not getting sent out before. That due, I think, in part to Marion's efforts. They are really housekeeping and don't deal with some of the major issues.
Thank you, Marion. Sticking up for us.
The final item, I'd like just a brief comment on capital improvements.
I hate to interrupt you, but I think there's going to be an explosion in here.
It is. A very strong smell of gas.
It is really pungent. Oh my God! That's
Jerry said, I guess that's the normal order.
Why we should adjourn by 10:00.
Well, maybe our first capital expenditure is to put up a buffer between us and the gas station.
I thought it was a gas leak.
I wish you would call me if any of you have any thoughts about what capital improvements you might like to see the town spend over $100,000 in the next 6 to 8 years. Such things as a land acquisition fund, increasing that, perhaps strengthening the corner up here at Shore Road, improving that situation after it's been studied. I think due to the environmental hazard that we will adjourn, unless there's not any further business.
I'd like to see a small study done. I don't think it would cost $100,000 to just look at our little business district here.
In this corner.
Just little business district.
That's good.
In anticipation of that, the little houses. You know, I mean, it's no big deal.
Yeah.
We've already got two curb cuts where we could have had one driveway.
I think that could very nicely fall into this Shore Road Scott Dyer intersection.
Thank you. All right.